I want to start this talk with being honest to you. A couple of weeks ago, I felt overwhelmed. I was living in the south of Portugal and I experienced a pretty intense summer. One of my closest friends died and I felt terribly alone. It was hard for me to focus and I actually wanted to quit this talk. But then I sat down and realized I need a change of perspective. So I decided to go on a weekend trip. And I packed my van, drove to a little bay in the national park, and, well, arriving in the afternoon was beautiful. I went straight for a surf, wanted to clear my mind, but it didn't work. Even the dinner in the sunset didn't make it any better, and I felt terrible. Finally, it was dark when I decided to go to the beach and just watch the stars. And this is where I want to invite you now. So please, close your eyes now and take a deep breath in. Make yourself comfortable. Imagine zillions of stars, little shiny dots painted on the black canvas of the universe. Maybe you can feel the sand supporting your bodies or the warm ocean breeze blowing from the south. My thoughts were running, and I was looking in the sky, and there was this thought. You've all had this thought before, probably. It was the thought of, is there life out there? And if so, how does it look like? How do they build their cities from their societies? I was really drifting. I had to go back to my breathing. But one thought that really stuck was the thought of, what if there actually is life out there? Maybe on this little shiny dot over there. And what if this life asks the same questions as I did before, just from another point of perspective? What does it see? It might see this, a blue planet, planet Earth, a planet full of life. But what is this planet and life, actually? Let's make two little observations. The first one is this. That's gravity. And if we like it or not, we stay here. And so does all the stuff around us, our cars, our houses, our waste. Within the boundaries of our atmosphere, everything stays here. That leads to the second observation. What is this everything, actually? Let's pick five simple chemical elements and see what we can build with them. First, we pick oxygen, as we all need to breathe. Adding hydrogen, we can now form water, H2O. And this beautiful molecule is the basic condition for life on our planet. Two-thirds of our planet are covered by water, and even our own bodies are made up to about 70% of water. If we add carbon now, we can form long-chain hydrocarbons. It's fuels like petrol and diesel that power our globalized world. But even we ourselves are powered by the very same elements. And I'm speaking of glucoses, the fuel of our own lives. It is produced by the plants performing their magic trick of photosynthesis, taking CO2 from the atmosphere, water from the ground, and the energy from the sun. If we eat plants or animals, we are powered ourselves by the sun. Remember that. We need to add the nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus as well, because the plants, as well as we ourselves, have to grow in our lives. And these five elements make up more than 95% of all the built and living mass around us, including our own bodies. We ourselves are made up to more than 90% of just these five elements. So, but what does that mean now? That means that the same atoms that are, for example, in the little finger of your left hand, they have been part of a tree, of an ocean wave, or a lion a couple of hundred years ago. And as we will die, these same atoms, they will end up in that tree, or wave, or lion in a couple of years again. Let that sink for a minute. As the blood circulates in our bodies, supporting, supplying our organs with all the stuff we need, all substances on our planet circulate in interwoven cycles. Water is life, and the water cycle is a complex fabric in our planet's natural system. So let's talk about water. As I already mentioned, our planet is full of water. The problem is, this is mainly salty ocean water. Less than 1% of the total water is accessible fresh water. So this scarce resource would be exhausted very quickly if it were not somehow renewed by the hydrologic cycle. So let's take a simplified look at how this atmospheric engine works. Close to the equator, this hot sun evaporates water from the oceans, like in a boiling water kettle on the stove. Thanks to cooler poles, the water vapor is then moved around the globe by wind. And eventually it falls back as rain to the Earth's surface. And driven by gravity, our rivers transport it back to the oceans. So now, coming from macrocosm to microcosm, let's observe in a natural watershed what happens to the water on its way. Maybe you can sit down in the front, make yourself comfortable. We can see the water vapor in the clouds and the snow in the slopes in the background. Imagine it rains, and for those of you who don't like the rain, imagine a hot day in summer and the ice melting. In both events, liquid water is flowing down the Rocky Mountain slope. It cannot infiltrate into the soil and forms what hydrologists call runoff. And this runoff eventually ends up in the little stream passing by our feet. But not all the runoff from the slopes ends up in that stream. Something important is happening on the way. So pull out your binoculars and focus on the transition from rocky slopes to vegetated ground. Plant leaves, mosses, and little swales add structure to the ground and prevent the water from rushing down the slope. Also, the subsoil conditions change from rigid rock to fluffy forest floor. They keep the ground permeable. They create open pores, and it acts like a sponge. The water can now infiltrate into the ground. Seeping deeper, it is cleaned by the earth and bacteria and finally feeds our precious groundwater resources. This still missing component of the natural water cycle is hard for us to see, but way better to feel. And maybe you want to close your eyes again just for a second for this. Because it is the cold feeling in your skin after an intense summer rain, or the fresh air you breathe while walking through a forest. Can open your eyes again. It is the evaporation of water from surfaces and through plant leaves. And together, this process is called evapotranspiration, and it cools down the surrounding environments. We have now identified four key elements of this natural system, and we'll apply them, but before we do that, we have to observe something else and follow the water down the stream. Can you see the landscape changing? Sorry. The first settlements appear, and agricultural fields as well. We're a lot of people on this planet, and our need for food and housing is immense. To meet those needs, we turn forests into farmland and observe urban growth rates, both at a pace that we've never, ever seen before. The result is a contrasting coexistence of mankind and nature. With uncovered soils, loss of vegetation, and sealed city surfaces, we have created perfect foundations for environmental disasters, and we have, by the way, managed to massively disturb all the four components of the natural water cycle we've observed before. But we are not only changing the tangible landscapes around us. Basing our globalized world and standard of living on mainly fossil resources, we are also changing the invisible environment around us, our atmosphere. Increased amounts of CO2 in the atmosphere cause an intensification of the hydrological cycle and following a temporal and spatial shift in climate and weather patterns. That means that in the future, we will experience more events of extreme rainfall and, ironically, longer-lasting periods of drought at the same time. probably you've all witnessed the consequences in the last years or months. In dry periods, we see desperate farmers fighting on their cracked ground for water, while in the meantime, we try to rescue our urban green with drinking water. And then maybe 2 weeks later, we find urban drainage systems overwhelmed by heavy rain. The fertile soil of our fields in the next river, and in the worst case, destructive floods wiping out entire settlements. And that is just the beginning. The outlook to the future, to put it in the words of the OECD for COP21, it will be cloudy with the chance of catastrophes. So, feeling overwhelmed by problems, it's always good to change the perspective. So we have two options now. The first option is we just pretend we've not heard the last 3 minutes and keep observing the clouds. The second option, we realize that in fact we do have major problems, but we also do have all the solutions. Remember our observations of the natural cycle. Let's find out together how we can apply those. The first stop is this high mountain farm in Austria. And in 2 years of permaculture training, I have seen with my own eyes how the Holzer family managed to restore a healthy water balance in the ground. They applied our earlier observations to the landscape. Guiding surface runoff with infrastructure elements as roads and swales and numerous decentral retention ponds, they managed to get the water back into the ground. Along beautiful water landscapes, they created a thriving farm right next to the eroding slopes you can see in the background. But why does that work? First, you put the water back into the ground. Second, vegetation will follow. Not only protecting the surface from drying out and being eroded, the roots are aerating and loosening the earth. Remember the magic trick of the beginning? So a part of the CO2 from the atmosphere is transported into the ground. Soil organisms like fungi and bacteria, they love that. And they break it down and store it into fertile soil called humus. And humus is a true multi-talent. Like a sponge, it can store immense amounts of water. It is a nutrient megastore for plants, protects our groundwater, and it is a carbon sink. We only need to put the water back into the ground and support the right vegetation on top. But if the terrain doesn't allow us major changes in the landscape, we can still change the system on top. We can adapt the cultivation lines of our fields to the contour lines of the terrain with the key line design. We support infiltration, we build up fertile earth, and create inspiring landscapes that even mitigate the effects and causes of climate change. And all these solutions are based on our earlier observations of the natural system. But what about our cities? What about the concrete jungles that in the last millennia became our natural habitat? Shall we put tons of humus on our streets now that act like a sponge? No. But inspired by nature, we can build and link so-called blue-green-gray infrastructure elements. And like humus, they are true multi-talents. I'm going to show you a couple of examples. Starting at the very top, a green roof acts like the fluffy forest floor. We already store some water up there in the ground. Putting plants on our buildings cools them down in summer and insulates them in winter. So we cut back the building's energy demand while pretending flooding on the streets and storing the water up on the earth. We can use the walls as well. Green facades are another building block of a climate-resilient city. They are actually the true jokers in hot summer days. Growing and developing their leaves, no matter where they are rooted, these plants perform their magic trick, and they create a new quality of urban life. They transpirate the water back into the air, and take the CO2 out of it. So imagine walking through the street, breathing clean, fresh air in a healthy microclimate like in a forest, and picking some fruit on the way. I love that. But Look at the street. Wherever possible, we must change sealed surfaces to permeable pavements and allow the water to get back into the ground. We can guide the remaining runoff to the next building block of a sponge city. Bioswales create retention spaces right next to our sidewalks. And the effect is not only a relieved sewer system and happy fish in the next river, we bring the water back into our cities as a visible element. And we can apply this concept to multifunctional spaces of any large scale, like here in Bishan Park in Singapore. Instead of fenced ugly obstacles, we give the water back to the ground and back to the people. We create livable cities where you engage with and benefit from nature as you just cannot miss it on your way. Landscapes and settlements that thrive. And all that is based on our observations of the natural water cycle. We understood the key elements of the system, how they work, and then we applied them to our own systems. It's not really complex, right? Quite simple. But one very important detail is missing, and that requires your help. Scientists prognosed the effects of climate change already back in the 1970s. The sponge city concept, regenerative farming, and water-sensitive urban design, all these concepts were developed a long time ago. So why do our cities still look like concrete jungles today? Why have we not changed our food production, our farms, from degeneration to regeneration? And to answer this question, I want to quote this guy. He revolutionized and enabled our modern world with his ideas. Albert Einstein. And he once said, "We cannot solve our problems with the same thinking we used when we created them." And I believe he is right. We need a revolution of thinking. We must evolve from linear business as usual thinking to circular, whole systems thinking, and then apply that to our modern world, to our designs, to our lives. We must rediscover and always remember that we are part of a bigger system. We are a part of nature, and we essentially depend on it. If you understood the thing with your little finger and being powered by the sun, please share that. Inspire people. Because we need more people to understand that and commit to a change that make a difference. And the big question, why do we need that? Because if the future of our planet, and actually we mean the future of our grandchildren's and their grandchildren's life on that planet, if that future is a book with yet empty pages, then let's make a difference together and write the next chapters together. Thank you.